Is the report believable?
Well, yeah, we find the US State Department Human Rights report adequate, accurate, and I think it, contrary to what the DFA is saying, I think we think it represents what's happening in the country as far as human rights is concerned.
But then why would EJ case be going on if this administration, number one, doesn't have the same drug war policy as the last administration? You have a president that just touted that it was the biggest drug haul without anyone being killed. In other words, they're completely different policies. So if it's accurate, why hasn't it changed?
Well, that's a good question, and several things to unpack there, Karen. One is that when you look at the behavior of law enforcers, the police, the PDA, and all of that, accountability is practically zero for all those abuses that were committed in the past. So wala pang nananagot. Na out of the thousands of cases, dalawa pa lang ang nagkaroon ng conviction. So this is impunity talaga because the authorities are being given so much, you know, leeway to do what they have been doing since 2016. So walang napapanagot, and you know how it is. If you're not punishing perpetrators, the abuses will continue. And second, it is not true that there's a change in policy already in the drug war, because regardless of what Mr. Marcos is saying about the shift, the drug war policy of Mr. Duterte is still in place. Mr. Marcos has not rescinded or junked the policies, the executive orders that made Oplan Tokhang, Operation Double Barrel possible. It's still there, and the police are still using it. So these combination of factors are the reason why the killings are happening. And just to, update the figure here, the U.S. State Department report said that 300 have been killed in the drug war under Marcos. Today, it's now more than 620. Have died in the drug war. And this is according to the UP Third World Study Center, DAHAS monitoring. So it is a very credible group of academics who are monitoring and documenting these cases. So, you know, again, going back, walang nananagot, there's no practically zero accountability. People are not being punished. So that's why all of these things are happening.
Okay, so you pointed two things there. Number one, the justice system is so slow that it doesn't elicit fear, right? For those who may want to perpetrate the crime. Number two, are you saying the president has to rescind the former president's orders? That would make a difference?
Well, on that point, I think it will make a very, very, you know, an extremely important difference. I mean, this is something that Amnesty yesterday pointed out. Mr. Marcos need to officially, unequivocally, explicitly rescind the order of the drug war, because as long as it's there, anybody from the police force can still use it, can still use it to justify whatever actions they make. And keep in mind, Karen, the drug war of Mr. Duterte that started in 2016, a lot of it is very, very abusive, and they got away with it because of all of these orders coming from the president's office. So Mr. Marcos really has to, you know, unequivocally rescind those orders and then communicate to the police that, look, stop the violence. I mean, we're not saying that the government should stop dealing with the drug issue, but stop the violence, stop the drug raids that are victimizing a lot of people, even innocent ones.
Mm-mm. Okay, Carlos, I'm curious. What Justice Secretary Rebullia says, there are reforms that are being put in place, right? Most likely there are. The intention for reforms is there and the effort for reforms is there. But is the problem more cultural than we think?
Well, we don't deny that the DOJ, for instance, have instituted reforms. I mean, they've been working, for instance, with the UN joint program of the United Nations. Yeah. To institute some of these reforms in, you know, detention, investigation, and all of that. And these are all well and good. That's why we supported the UNJP for as long as we have. The problem is that many of what we're seeing here are the result of a broken down criminal justice system and judicial system in the Philippines. This is not just one problem. This is not just the police being abusive. This is a combination of other things. This is also, we have a very, very draconian and very, very punitive drug law in the Philippines that jails even the smallest offender. At wala tayong tinatawag na yung harm reduction policy or program ng gobyerno. So, and then we have a court system that's so heavily clogged with cases, with not enough judges, not enough courts. So may bottleneck sa court system natin, sa criminal justice system. And yet...
But then that's harder to solve.
It
right?
is harder to solve.
That's harder.
Yeah. Which is why we like what the DOJ is doing in terms of incrementally trying to resolve that. Because these things will not be solved in a matter of months, not even years. This will be probably take a generation to do.
Yeah.
But again, and the problem is that Mr. Marcos inherited a drug war that created so much havoc. And the response na nangyayari sa ginagawa nila ngayon are not enough to address this issue. So we're talking about accountability. We're talking about closure. We're talking about justice. So hindi pwedeng sabihin na lang na okay na tayo, okay na kami sa human rights, and then that's that. No, it has to do more.
Mm-mm. The problem with the drug war that was instituted, I think, is just to reiterate, it wasn't successful in putting behind bars big drug lords. Essentially, it was small players, right? Yeah. Small players in the drug trade that were victimized. Users, small pushers, yun yung background.
Yeah. Well, in fact, that's the reason why we call the drug war of Mr. Duterte a bogus drug war, because it was going after really small-time, you know, users and peddlers. And every now and then, may mga raids sa mga malalaki. But then, you know, much of the violence was targeted against young poor Filipinos. Now, which brings me actually to what this 1-point-something billion drug haul of the Marcos administration had. I mean, we applaud that, and we agree with the president when he said that look, it can be done without shedding bloodshed. And that can be done. That's what we've been saying. The problem is that it's not something that's consistent, okay? Mm-hmm. The government needs to go after the drug trade, obviously, but it needs to have more institutional reforms, drug policy reforms. It needs to amend the drug law in the Philippines. And we're happy that, I think last week, the DOJ again and the Department of many other departments launched what they call... a drug policy reform initiative summit in June, and to look into what the drug laws in the countries have created in terms of problems or opportunities, and that is good. That's the way to go. But I think more importantly, Karen, the drug war needs to veer away from looking at the drug issue as a crime and public safety issue. This is a health issue, first and foremost.
I think that's worth a full discussion, seeing drugs as a health issue instead of simply a crime issue. Although when you are addicted to illegal substances, you're bound to commit crimes.
Well, that's the kind of mindset that the authorities are trying to instill in the public. And Mr. Duterte actually went to town with that idea. But really, there's a lot of research going on that says, you know, that tries to make a more nuanced view of drug use and crime. And it's not at all true that people who take drugs are, you know, automatically become violent. No, that's not necessarily true. Now, that's not saying that the drug problem is not a drug problem. It is an issue. But again, it has to be addressed in a rights-respecting manner. Just because people use drugs, they don't necessarily lose their human rights.
Okay. So if you were to recommend to President Marcos Jr. in response to the U.S. State Department report, what would you say? Number one, rescind former President Duterte's executive orders. Make it clear, rescind it. And then what? Institute a new policy? Is that correct?
Yes, institute a new policy. Again, human rights-based approach policy. Kasama dito yung harm reduction. Now, the whole idea of the harm reduction strategy, in a nutshell, it is that, you know, you you reduce the harm of drug or substance use on the individual and on the community by not being punitive. You know, this entails community-based drug rehabilitation na talagang voluntary. Yun ang nangyayari kasi yun coercive. Because once you coerce people to go into drug treatment, you're creating more problems than solving them. So it has to be a much more, I think, expansive view of the drug problem. And second, another recommendation to Mr. Marcos really is to really order the police, stop the violence, and also accountability, order the courts, you know, order the DOJ. Make sure that the investigations into these past cases are actually moving along.
Okay, I was going to ask you about that. Should there be a special court, especially for police officers, and a specific rule that within the year, the case is decided, whether not guilty, guilty. Timetable, special court.
Well, actually, a lot of groups in the Philippines have been advocating for the creation of special courts.
Just specifically for the police, right?
But for the police specifically, there's a discussion on that because keep in mind, Karen, meron na namang mechanisms within the government that will hold police misconduct to account. You know, we have the Ombudsman for the Military and Police Personnel. We have within the PNP, we have the Internal Affairs Service. The problem is that these units of the PNP, these programs are not functioning as well as they should. As we saw in the drug war of Mr. Duterte, they're taking directives directly from the president. So if you are an AAS, and with all due respect to them, to the officers there who are doing their job, kung ang presidente na mismo magsasabi sa iyo, go out and kill, what do you do? Diba? Mm-hmm. So it begins from the top. So really, the value here of Mr. Marcos communicating to the police, you know, na hindi lang to pursue the drug war, but to pursue it in a way that will not result in violence, will not disrespect due process. It's very, very important.
All right. On that note, I want to thank you so much for joining me today, Senior Researcher of the Human Rights Watch, Carlos Conde. Thank you for joining me, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Karen.